Well, hello and welcome to our traditional service here at St Andrew's and All Saints in Malvern. It's great to have you with us, and wherever you are watching from, you are really welcome. And a special welcome today to Ailey and Jean and Jane, who are our new friends watching from Australia, Queensland, Australia. It's so lovely to have you with us. And we're delighted that Ailey is going to be bringing our Bible reading to us later on. And this week we found this picture, which has been in the vestry for a while, which is the choir from 1982, which has a picture of Jean and her husband Ralph in. And it's been lovely to share those memories and hear some other stories that have been coming out of there. Today we're going to be continuing our series on how to unhurry learning to live at the pace of God. And Barry, one of our readers, is going to be bringing our third practice to us today, which is the practice of simplicity. And this week in church, particularly on Friday, we've been praying as part of the Archbishop's call to prayer for this month of lockdown. To pray for our nation, to pray for our communities. And on Friday, many people came into church here to pray at our prayer stations, and we're going to use those prayer stations in our prayers later on. And we're going to be continuing to pray here in church on Fridays and on Zoom at 9 and 12 and 6 every Friday of lockdown, to continue to lift up our prayers for our nation and ourselves to God. But as we come to worship now, let's just be still, and let's just, in the quiet, let go of those anxieties and worries, those things on our minds, and let us come before God, our Maker. And we say these opening sentences together. From scattered lives, we come to worship. From good weeks and bad weeks, we come to worship. Bringing great times and painful memories, we come to worship. Needing healing, needing peace, we come to worship. With hope in our hearts, we come to worship. To the Almighty God, we come to worship. To the King of Kings, we come to worship. Separate, but together, we come to worship. And instead of singing our first hymn today, we're going to do it slightly differently, continuing this theme of just meeting God in the silence. And we're going to play some music, and particularly we're going to focus on this first prayer station, which is a place of just being with God, with several pictures, just to allow us to enter in God's presence. And as the music plays and as we look at some of the pictures, I'm going to read some verses of scripture. And I encourage you just to dwell in those verses. Maybe one of them really will resonate with you. Verses which speak of our gracious and loving God. Verses which invite us to come into his presence and find rest. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love and faithfulness. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. Be still and know that I am God.
The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. So come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand.
So having heard the greatness of God and his invitation to us, we come to God acknowledging that we've not lived as God wanted us to live. And so we come to bring our confession to God. Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let us turn away from sin and turn to the Lord, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. And so, Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, this is not the way I introduce it normally, I'm delighted to say we have our Bible reading all the way from Australia.
The reading this morning comes from Australia, from Budrum Mountain on the Sunshine Coast in the state of Queensland. Jean Parker, who has strong links with St Andrews and All Saints, Jane McIntyre and I send greetings to all. And we thank Reverend Dave for the very warm welcome he has extended to our little group from down under. We thank him too for his inspirational spiritual leadership, which has brought joy, encouragement, and comfort into our lives. It is an immense pleasure to read the lesson this morning from Matthew 6, verses 19 to 34. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. If your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon, in all his splendor, was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? My friends all drive Porsches. I must make amends. Worked hard all my lifetime, no help from my friends. So, oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz?
So, do you remember that song, that distinctive gravelly voice? Janis Joplin, 1970. Now, simplicity is the title of today's talk, and I expect you're wondering what that song's got to do with it. Well, in fact, what do the readings have to do with simplicity when they talk of treasure, darkness, worry, clothes, anxiety? What do all those things have to do with simplicity? Well, let me first talk about what I think the problem is, because there's no point in preaching what you think God is saying is a solution unless one works out there may be a problem. So let me start with a question. Would you like to have lots of stuff, lots of possessions? Or would you prefer a life with fewer possessions, fewer or less stuff? Or maybe you think, well, I've probably got the balance about right. I live somewhere in between excess and poverty. And in our consumer-orientated society, kind of having more feels better, doesn't it, really, than having less? So let's go back to basics and see what the problem might be. If you're like me, you would like to be like Jesus. I guess all of us listening to this would want to be like Jesus. And we used to sing a song, I want to be like Jesus. But the dilemma for us, in a way, is if Jesus were here today, how would he be? Would he have a smartphone? How many hours might he spend on social media? Would he have a lovely new espresso coffee machine like mine? Would he binge on Netflix series or vote for a particular party or own a bike or a car or two cars? Would he go travelling around the world sightseeing? Be an animal rights activist or a climate activist? Would he live on a social housing estate or in a big detached house or even in a palace? Would he be a meat eater, a vegetarian, a pescatarian, a vegan? Would he go to the gym and work out? I don't think he'd like Pilates. Think about it. Would he wear designer clothes or ethically produced clothing? And would he give generously? And if so, to which causes and charities? What would Jesus do? Oh my goodness, what a dilemma. Would it be a life of simplicity, as the sermon obviously suggests it would be? And if it was a life of simplicity, what is the great advantage of that? And what does it look like anyway? In the book, The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, which we're all being encouraged to read, John Comer states that a simplicity, or minimalism as he calls it, is for the followers of Jesus not just a lifestyle, but a spiritual discipline. A way of, as it were, clearing the clutter from our homes and our hearts and our lives. So we can make more room for God and live freely in the kingdom of God with Jesus. That's the point of simplicity. Less clutter, more room, more time. Oh, we'll all sign up for that, won't we? But the dilemma is, what does it look like? What does it actually look like? And we've got to find some kind of Jesus benchmark, as it were, a godly benchmark against which we can assess our own lives today with all its 21st century challenges in our developed Western and mainly secular society. Now, the Bible and Jesus' teaching won't give us specific answers about whether we can watch lots of Netflix series or binge on our smartphones, but it does give very clear principles, and Jesus gives very clear commands. And in the readings today, we heard him give commands, not sort of suggestions like, oh, wouldn't it be nice if, commands. So do not store up for yourselves treasure on earth. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve both God and money. Do not worry about your life. Do not worry saying, what shall I eat? What shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? Seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. So Jesus isn't actually saying, you know, wealth is bad and poverty is good. He's not saying that at all. He's saying that an abundance of stuff, clutter, an obsessive desire, as it were, for stuff is not healthy for our spiritual lives. John Comer has grasped this, and he's leading us to see our lives in this developed world as having missed something important, some big truths about Jesus. And I know you know this, and I know that you know I know this, but here's the rub. You know, how does following Jesus impact on our actual lifestyles? You know, the day-to-day lifestyles that we choose to live, or have to live, perhaps. I mean, really, if Jesus were alive today, and well, he is in one sense, but if he was physically manifested in Malvern, let's say, walking around, you know, how different would his lifestyle be to others? Would non-Christians say, oh, wow, look at that Jesus. What a truly inspirational lifestyle he leads. And if Jesus were here in Malvern, how different would our lifestyles be? Would non-Christians say, oh, look at Jesus's friends. What truly inspirational lives and lifestyles they lead. Jesus spoke of two principal ambitions, as it were, to love God and to love our neighbours. And to do that, he needed, to do that fully, I would say, he needed to live a simple lifestyle. Had he had, you know, a palace to manage, servants to to look after, staffing disputes, budgets to balance, he would not have had so much time to love God and love others. And here's the thing, in our modern Christian lives, we tend to have sort of worship words and theories as much as we have issues about actions. And here's the thing, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth and the life. And Christians, if you look at Acts chapter 9, you'll find that Christians were called followers of the way. And so to be a follower of Jesus was, and perhaps is, or should be, to live like him, to follow his way. And whilst beliefs, theology and ethics all play their part, sometimes in the Western church we can put theology very much first, our personal salvation. Ethics, a godly perspective, as it were, on things, second, and the way, a godly life, a third. And I would imagine many of us ache for transformation. We read of Jesus, his joy, his peace, his love for the Father, his love for others. And we want that, we do. We want life in all its fullness. And we hear about the easy yoke and we say, give me that, please. And we head home from church, fired up. And we go right back to our groove, the slot that we're in, because that's what we're conditioned. Nothing changes. What's the answer? Are we all supposed to go into the woods and live on bark and twigs? Well, of course not. We have so many great things to be grateful for. Our wealth has provided us with health services, amazing health services, heat, shelter, food, warmth, entertainment, and so forth. But our relative wealth and lifestyles haven't actually resulted in a population who are richly blessed with contentment, joy, peace, generosity, compassion, and so forth. And nobody is advocating poverty. Jesus didn't advocate poverty. He encouraged us to see that nobody lived in poverty. But if on the other side, wealth brings clutter, busyness, materialism, and a frenzied consumerism, and that of course can come from wherever you are on the economic scale, as John Comer says, it will bring a catastrophic damage to the soul of our society. And the lie that more is good, he says, is wreaking havoc on our emotional health and spiritual lives. So the answer in a way for us is to follow his way, to follow Jesus's way. We have to focus our attention on God, and that's why the readings link money, stress, because we know to find God in our lives is to find him completely consistent, trustworthy, reliable and faithful to us. And you know that the more we lift our eyes from our problems to focus on the goodness of God, you know, through worship, through prayer, through embracing him in creation, whatever it is works for you, we know that we can become increasingly non-anxious, a non-anxious presence. We can see the bigger picture. We get a better perspective. We become less controlling, more relaxed and peaceful because we have the answers. Well, no, but because we do know that ultimately love wins. In the words of Julian of Norwich, that well-known 14th century nun, all shall be well and all shall be well. And all manner of things shall be well. So I've given you the problem. I've articulated the answer. Follow his way and there we are. Job done. Well, not really, because we still don't know what that looks like. And John Comer, and you can read this in the book, chapter on simplicity, gives some practical examples. And I'm going to run through those fairly briefly because they're useful. They actually give us a handle. Maybe this is the Jesus benchmark that I was looking for. One, before you buy something, ask yourselves a few questions. And I'm not really talking about cornflakes here. Firstly, is it ethically produced? Actually, probably I am talking about cornflakes as well, because we should be looking at where we can to buy fair trade food. So is it ethically produced, whatever it is? Can I afford it? How often will I use it? Will it add value and help me enjoy God and his world even more, or will it distract me? Will it help slow down the pace of my life? Is it oppressing the poor? I mean, you think about it, you know, we can buy jeans for like £6, and how do you think a pair of jeans is made, created, transported, given to a shop, bought by us for £6, and yet the person that makes it gets a fair wage? We know that many children are involved in sweatshops, so are we actually trying to find out more about where we buy things and what conditions people were working in? Is it harming the earth? You know, in other words, will it biodegrade or will it last for 500 years in landfill? Number two, buy fewer but better things. Have you found recently when you've been buying stuff that seems to be really cheap that actually at the end of the day, it's not very good, it's, the quality's poor, it's junk, you know, it breaks and you end up having to buy something else or another one of the same thing. So try and find things, we're stewards of God's creation, we need to find things that last longer. Where we can, let's share. Last summer I lent my high pressure water jet thing, you know, water cleaner, to somebody, and unfortunately it kind of shorted out all their electrics, so they weren't too happy. But, you know, actually, if anybody wants to borrow my high pressure water thing, please ask. You know, sharing is good. Sharing is good. We don't often use a lot of stuff that we've got. Bless others by giving away generously and regularly. You know, I quite like going to the charity shop and giving stuff away. It feels good, and it's nice to think that you can bless somebody else with something that you don't really need so much. Live to a budget. Well, that's fairly self-evident, I guess. Learn to enjoy things without owning them. Library books, that's a good example. The local parks. We're blessed with so many beautiful parks and commons around us. We should enjoy them. And you know, on that theme, developing a real appreciation of creation. Because if materialism despiritualizes us, then the material world, as it were, can help to re-energize, has the opposite effect. It re-spiritualizes us, God's creation. Cultivate a deep appreciation of the simple things, like, you know, a nice cup of coffee. In fact, I've been dying to have this from my new coffee machine, he says guiltily. The old one blew up. It did. You asked Debs. It went all smoky and horrible, and we couldn't do anything about it. We tried. Honestly, we did. But, you know, a simple cup of tea in the morning is lovely, isn't it? And a home-cooked meal, riding a bike in the sunny day. Every sunrise is an invitation, in a sense, to enjoy God's world. This one is a good one. Recognising advertising for what it is. I like that one. And as he says, it's one area where cynicism feels Jesus-y. Quite like that. And finally, the point he makes here is about leading a cheerful, happy revolt against materialism. You know, less is better. And when we moved house, we cleared a load of stuff out, a load of junk. Actually, not all junk. Some of it was okay. And we took it to the charity shop. And the sort of more minimalist approach we had when we first moved to Melbourne seemed quite healthy. I'm looking around the room now as I speak, and we've collected stuff again, you know. I mean, you go to people's houses, how many people have these great racks of DVDs they never watch, or bookshelves full of books they never read? You know, just a thought. Clear it all out. Do not store up for yourselves, says Jesus, treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Leading a simple lifestyle gives us time and more money and more energy to invest in a relationship with God, a relationship with family and friends, kingdom work and life in the kingdom. And maybe, you know, who knows, one day people might look at us and say, wow, what a truly inspirational lifestyle they lead. Well, we started with a song, and I'm going to finish with a song. This time, the last word goes to, what is it, old Blue Eyes? Frank Sinatra. And now the end is near. And so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I've travelled each and every highway, and more, much more than this, I did it His way. Thank you.
So thanks, Barry, for those thoughts and for those suggestions as to how we can live this stuff out really practically, how we can live life more simply in line with God's values. But I guess our response isn't just saying I'm going to do a tick list of things that I'm suggested to do, but this is about asking God to transform our hearts, to soften our hearts, to align our desires for His desires. And we're going to now go into a final song, which is, as the deer pants for water, so my soul longs for you. It's a song which speaks of our desires not being for silver and gold, but our desires being for God and to live His way and to draw closer to Him. So I encourage you to reflect on these words now. You might like to sing, you might like to pray, you might like to just sit and listen. But just allow God to continue to minister to you and draw you into His presence and align your desires with His.
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you Spirit healed. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You're my friend, and you are my brother. To worship you.
And so we're going to have an extended time of prayer now. And we're going to take you around each of the prayer stations here at St Andrew's and invite you to join in with the prayers that many have been praying in this last few days and will do in the next few days as we pray for the nation. And so we begin by praying for our town of Malvern. And I invite you to think of your street. Who lives there? Perhaps what are their needs? And just in this moment, pray for them. And I invite you to think of perhaps some of the organisations that are working in Malvern, the schools, the health service, the council, the different organisations and businesses who serve our town. Perhaps just think of something that God leads you to pray for and pray for that and God's blessing on it right now. And we say the prayer of blessing for Malvern on our noonday prayer. In the name of Jesus, we bless the town of Malvern and its people at this time. We bless all the relationships in this town, marriages, families, neighbours, work colleagues, and friendships, that they may be strong and whole. We bless you that there may be peace and love, care and understanding flowing between all in these challenging days. We bless the businesses, the community organisations, the health services, the care homes, those working with young people, the churches. We bless you that together we may support and serve each other. In the name of Jesus, we bless the town of Malvern, that we will be delivered from this virus, and that in these months, hearts will be softened towards God and drawn towards him. We bless you that the kingdom values will flourish afresh, and that hearts will be transformed and aligned with God's heart for our communities and our neighbours. We bless all who live and work here, that all the blessings of the presence of the kingdom of God may fall upon you. Amen. And we move on now to praying for our world. And we continue to pray for America and all those preparing for a transition of power in that country. Lord, may you bring your peace. We think of our national leaders here in the UK. We pray for wisdom for them as they know how to deal with the current situation with the pandemic. And we pray for other world leaders too. And I invite you in the quiet just to lift up to God any particular countries which God puts on your hearts to pray for right now. Lord, may your kingdom come in all the world. And we move on now to praying for our children and our young people. And we thank you for each and every one of them. We thank you for those in our own churches and for Eddie and for Helen and their teams as they serve and support our children and young people. We pray for our local schools, for the Chase, for Malvern Parish, for Malvern Wells and the Witch Schools, for all those teachers and the head teachers and all those supporting in those schools and all the pupils. Would you keep them safe and make them a place where people can flourish and grow in your values? We think of perhaps children and young families who are in need at this time and who the pandemic has really hits heart. And perhaps in the quiet, I invite you to lift up any individuals and families to God right now. Lord, may your kingdom come amongst our children and young people. And we pray for our churches, Lord, the churches of St Andrews and All Saints, and for all the churches in Malvern particularly. We pray that at this time of transition that you would guide us in your way, you would show us what your vision is for us as churches. You will show us where we need to let go of things from the past and where you want to build afresh. And in the quiet, I invite you to just pray for our churches and to listen to God for anything he might want to say to us as churches right now. Lord, may your kingdom come in our churches. And finally, we pray for all those who are weary and heavy laden, those who are struggling with anxiety or ill health or bereavement or loneliness. And in the quiet, I invite you to lift up some individual names of people who you want to pray for today. Lord, may your kingdom come. May you grant them peace and comfort and healing and strength. And so we finish our prayers by saying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, thank you once again for joining us today for our service. And we hope you find it an encouragement. And we look forward to you joining again with us next week. Just a reminder that the prayer stations at St Andrews will be open again on Friday, this Friday coming, and the following Friday too, from 9 in the morning to 9 in the evening. We do encourage you to come and just find a bit of time to come and be with God in this place. And also you can join us for corporate prayer on Zoom at 9 in the morning, at noon, and at 6 p.m. too. And if you want to pray from home, then also on the mailing and on the website, we've also got some prayers that Thy Kingdom Come have put together to encourage us to pray for different topics each day as we join with the nation and many praying around this country to pray for the same thing. So do continue to be part of this month of prayer for the nation with us. And so a final blessing as we go from here. May God give to you and all those you love his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. God bless and take care, and we look forward to seeing you next week.